I think it was William Schreiner who said, "I want to die in my sleep like my grandfather, not screaming and yelling like the passengers in his car." It was Woody Allen who said, "I'm not afraid of death, I just don't want to be there when it happens." Death is so terrifying that we have to joke about it. We just don't know what to do with it. Every once in a while, someone will bring it up. We think briefly and change the subject as quickly as we can. My dad is in his low 80s now. And I've heard him say on a number of occasions recently the following phrase: "My future is much shorter now than my history. My future is much shorter now than my history." And I heard him say it recently, and then I realized I'm approaching my 49th birthday, and I thought, oh my goodness, mine is too. My future is shorter than my history. It's a little sobering, isn't it? Life is short, then we die. How's that for a summary of the human condition? There's more to it than that, but that's pretty much it. Life is short, and then we die. One day, every one of us will breathe our last breath. When you contemplate that and realize that you will be doing that by yourself, how does that make you feel? I mean, honestly, how does that make you feel? There are two inevitables in life. You know what they are, right? Death and taxes. There's a popular topic nowadays. Well, I'm not going to be preaching on taxes. For many of us, it's terrifying to think of breathing our last and dying. But for many of us, what is more terrifying is someone that we love dearly dying before we do. Libby and I talk all the time. I've told her, "I want to go first." And she says, "Why?" I said, "Because then I get to skip dealing with you going before me." She said, "That's unbelievably selfish." I said, "I'm good with that. You're much stronger than me. I think you'll deal with me dying much better than I'll deal with you dying." She goes, "Yeah, I think you're right." Some of you have lost your spouse. In fact, after a first hour, a dear brother, been around here forever, came up. His wife of many, many decades passed away 2 days ago. Unbelievably painful. Some of you have lost a child or a sibling or a parent. And the pain is like a migraine headache of the soul, right? This pulsating, throbbing pain and nausea, and all you want to do is sleep so you can escape the pain for a little while, but your pain won't let you sleep, and day passes, and day passes, and day passes, and you wonder if you'll ever breathe freely again. And then you're paging through 1 Corinthians 15 one day, and you come across that little poem that's taken from the Old Testament. "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting?" And you're reading it, and you're going, "I feel like this person's death has victory over me, and I feel the sting. I feel it." One of the great joys of being a pastor, and many of you have experienced this being the pastor of your small group, even in a lay capacity, is you get to share people's big moments together. In seminary, they call it hatching, matching, and dispatching. The hatching part is the baby dedications and bringing children into the world. The matching is the joy of weddings. I mean, there's nothing as a pastor like standing there with a young bride and a young groom and the groom holding them up while the bride comes down the aisle. I mean, it's just great. I love that stuff. And then the dispatching one is obviously really hard. And it's not just performing funeral services. It's the call in the middle of the night saying, "Pete, come quickly." And you end up in someone's home, and their loved one has just passed. and the pain and the grief is palpable. And at the same time, in believing homes, there's a joy and a rest that's supernatural. It's a sacred moment. Now, there's a family in this church that I've gotten to enjoy and experience and walk through the big moments with. First time I met them, they were asking me to do their wedding. Young couple. I sat down with him. I realized that he was a believer, but she wasn't. I said, we've got a problem, and talked about the whole unequally yoked thing, and she wasn't very happy with me. She came back a few days later and said, explain this to me. I walked her through the gospel, and she gave her life to Christ, and she was radically transformed, an amazing transformation. A few months later, I did their wedding, which was really a cool day. I dedicated all three of their children. And then a few years later, I buried their little daughter who lost her battle with cancer. Is there anything more painful than that? And in those moments when I've been in people's homes and the pain, the acute pain, a pain unlike anything they've ever experienced before is filling the room. There's a text of Scripture I go to every time. And it's the text I'm going to take you to today. It's in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It's written to this church in Thessalonica, this little church that Paul planted. He preached Christ crucified and risen there. And Acts 17 tells us that a small number of Jews said yes to Christ. A larger number of God-fearing Gentiles did. And a handful of just outright pagans did as well. And all these newly redeemed people formed this little thing called a church in Thessalonica. And it tells us in Acts 17:5 that as soon as this church came together, it said the Jews were jealous. So they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. I mean, as soon as the church was born, they were under persecution. And they continued under persecution month after month, year after year. They were struggling with discouragement. Paul had heard this in some way, shape, or form. And so he wrote them this letter. It's called 1 Thessalonians in our Bible, to encourage them. And one of the reasons they were struggling is because Paul had taught them, Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. And so they all assumed that Jesus would come back before anyone died. But then people started dying in their church. Some of them may have died because of the persecution. We don't know why they were dying. But what we do know is that they were dying. And now they were confused. Uh-oh, Jesus hasn't come back yet. What happens to the people who have died when Jesus comes back? And apparently this question got back to Paul. And this text is designed to give encouragement to those who have lost those they love. In fact, in verse 18, he says, therefore, encourage each other with these words. This is an encouraging passage, so let me encourage you. Verse 13 of 1 Thessalonians 4. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, those who die, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. Paul is not saying don't grieve. Obviously, we're going to grieve when we lose someone we love. He's saying don't grieve like those who have no hope. We as believers grieve differently than those who don't have Christ. The mindset about death in the ancient world was summarized in a poem by Catullus. It went like this. The sun can set and rise again, but once our brief light sets, there is one unending night to be slept through. Blech. When you live, you die, and then there's just this unending nothingness that you just exist in. This is what most people thought happened after you died. It's a discouraging thought. Paul says, we think differently. Look at verse 14. We believe, circle the word believe. We believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe. Okay, we believe something. Why do we believe it? We believe because God did something in the past that we can look back on. What did he do? He rose a man from the dead. And because he rose a man from the dead historically, we can trust that one day he will do it again for us. So our belief is always grounded in the death and resurrection of Jesus. We believe that Jesus died and rose again. So we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Since Jesus has been raised, he'll raise us too. The hope of the resurrection means that death is not viewed as a permanent state, but as a temporary condition. We see death differently than the rest of the world. Alexander McLaren puts it this way, quote, "Death is but a passage. It's not a house, it's only a vestibule. The grave has a door on its inner side." I love that. If you're in Christ, your grave will have a door on the inner side. We'll put you in your grave, and you'll slip out the other side. So the specific question they were asking is, okay, but Paul, when Jesus comes back, what happens to those who have already died? And so he addresses that in verse 15. "According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep." Paul had taught them that when Jesus comes back, he will raise us up. And what he's saying here is that those of us who are still alive will not be raised up first. Those who have already died will be raised up first. He says that in verse 16. "For the Lord himself, as Jesus, will come down from heaven with a loud command." This is a military command. It evokes authority and power. "With the voice of the archangel." This is a voice that will stop everyone on the planet in their tracks. I can't wait to hear it. "And with the trumpet call of God." Our seventh grader, Liam, plays the trumpet. It's awesome. He's actually really good, and he practices at home, but he likes to walk around the house practicing. And if you know anything about a trumpet, it's kind of loud, and so we encourage him to go to his room and close the door, which he does. But even there, on the other side of the house with his door closed, when he's practicing, you can hear it anywhere in the house. The sound of a trumpet travels, my friends. And this is the trumpet call of God. One day Jesus is going to come back, a voice will sound, the archangel will speak, everyone will freeze, and the air will be filled with the most magnificent trumpet you've ever heard. Everyone's attention will be grabbed. It's going to be quite a moment. "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ," only if they were believers when they died, "the dead in Christ will rise first." So apparently they will come forth first. After that, verse 17, "we who are still alive and are left will be caught up." Underline "caught up." It's the Greek word harpazo. It means to seize or to snatch. We will be snatched up, right? "Together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air." And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words. These are encouraging words. Because what it says is those that we loved and lost, we will meet once again in the air. Circle that word "meet." It means to go out towards someone when a dignitary is coming for a formal presentation. So someone who's very important is coming, and so you go out to meet them. You don't want to just wait for them to get there. You want to make sure they feel very welcome, right? We will go to meet Jesus. A dignitary is coming, and apparently we will go forth to meet him in the air. Many of you remember last year, Governor Rick Perry came to attend church here at Bent Tree. And we found out on Tuesday that he was coming, and we spent the rest of the week preparing for his arrival. On that Sunday, he wanted to meet us back in the offices before he came into the worship center. And so we were all back there. We were all prepared. His Secret Service agents came in, and they made sure everything was cool. And then we went out to meet him, and we brought him into the worship service. And it was so weird. I've never done anything like this before. To have someone who's important coming to you, what do you want to do? You want to prepare, and then you want to go out and meet them there. And that's what this text is all about. We are going to go and meet him, and he wants us to prepare for that day. He wants us to prepare for that day. It says we will meet him in the air together with them, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. For many, death is the ultimate end of human existence. For Paul, the ultimate end for believers is life. Life that never ends. This text is pastoral in nature. It's designed for all of us who shepherd people, and many of you shepherd people. It's designed for us to have a text to take people who are grieving to. It's designed for people who have lost loved ones in Christ to encourage them. Unfortunately, it's become instead the source of tremendous debate. The debate centers around the second coming of Jesus. What happens to believers when Jesus comes back? The question is this: once we meet Jesus in the air, do we then go with him back to heaven, like a U-turn? Or do we meet Jesus in the air and then he keeps right on coming down to earth and then we come back down to earth with him? You say, well, what's the difference? Well, there's a huge difference. That question kind of separates evangelicals into two camps as far as what happens in the end times. Those who believe that we meet Jesus in the air and then go back to heaven, they call this event the rapture. We then are in heaven while certain things happen on earth, and it really depends on your view what happens on earth during that time. If the rapture was pre-tribulational, that's before the tribulation, then the tribulation happens. If the rapture was post-tribulation, that's after the tribulation, then the tribulation's already passed. If you believe in the mid-tribulational rapture of the church, then about half of the tribulation takes place, and then the rapture happens, and about half is played out. And all those things are things people love to argue about. And so we find this pastoral text that's designed to bring comfort to people who are grieving the loss of a loved one. And what do we do with it? We argue about the specific timing of when Jesus is going to do this. If we believe that we come back down to earth with Jesus immediately, then we see that as the second coming or the parousia. That's the only time that Jesus comes back. And then we see the millennial reign of the Lord, 1,000 years happening after that. And there are a whole bunch of evangelicals who believe that's what happens. So we're going to figure out which one it is right now. Let's go back to verse 17 and we'll see what happens. It says, after that, we who are still in the air and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Okay, we're about to find out which way we go. You ready? And so we will be with the Lord forever. Where? Are we coming here? Are we going there? My friends, the passage is inconclusive. Does it leave room for us doing a U-turn? Absolutely. If you believe that, you have good reason to believe that. Does it leave room for us coming down to earth? Categorically. If you believe that, you have very good reason to believe that. We're not going to worry about that right now, because that's not the point of the text. The point of the text is you've lost someone you love and you want to know, are you ever going to see him again? And the answer is absolutely. If they are in Christ, you will be meeting them in the sky and you will be forever with him, with them. And Paul says, encourage one another with these words. Encourage one another with these words. There's a Peanuts cartoon. Lucy and Linus are having a conversation. Not a congregation. Lucy says, boy, look at it rain. It's just pouring outside. What if it floods the whole world? Well, it'll never do that, says Linus. In the 9th chapter of Genesis, God promised Noah that would never happen again, and the sign of the promise is the rainbow. You've taken a great load off my mind, Lucy replies. Linus says, sound theology has a way of doing that. Sound theology has a way of doing that. My friends, I'm teaching you sound theology. Jesus is coming back. And when he does, we who are in Christ, dead or alive, at that moment will meet him in the air. And either there or here, somewhere, we will be with him forever. This is sound theology that will take a load off your mind. Dr. Martin Luther King speaking at the funeral of four young girls killed by a racist bomb in Birmingham, Alabama in 1963, said these words: "I hope you can find some consolation from Christianity's affirmation that death is not the end. Death is not a period that ends the great sentence of life, but a comma that punctuates it to more lofty significance. Death is not a blind alley that leads the human race into a state of nothingness, but an open door which leads into eternal life. Let this daring faith, this great invincible surmise, be your sustaining power during these trying days." End quote. You say, okay, Pete, I get it. This text is supposed to encourage us when we've lost someone we love, that it's raising more questions than it's answering about what happens at the end. That is true. If you're looking for answers about the end in this text, you'll have more questions when you're done than answers. But the question that most people want to know is, when's this going to happen? When is Jesus coming back? I mean, it would be good to know that, wouldn't it? I mean, like, we knew when Governor Perry was coming, so we knew we had to get ready. So if we just knew when Jesus was coming, then we'd know when we could mess around till, and then we'd get ready. So I'm about to tell you when he's coming. This is good information to have. Are you ready? Chapter 5, verse 1. "Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you." Paul's just not giving us a whole lot of information on the details here, is he? Why would Paul say we're not going to write to you about when it's going to happen? Because Jesus has already told us that it's futile to try and figure out when it'll happen. In Mark chapter 13, verse 32, Jesus said, "No one knows about that day or that hour. Not even the angels in heaven," listen, "not even the Son, but only the Father knows." Jesus, the Son of God, fully God and fully man, looked at the people around him and said, stop trying to figure out when it's going to happen. I don't even know. Believe me, if I don't know, you're not going to figure it out. You're not. The one thing we can say confidently about anyone who thinks that they've figured out the date is that they are all wrong. They're all wrong. The temptation is to try and figure out the dates. It's just that. It's a temptation. And like any temptation, it distracts us from what we're supposed to be focused on. So we don't know when it's going to happen. What do we know? Well, let's keep reading. Verse 2. "For you know," okay, we're about to find out what we do know. "For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." Here's what we do know. You ever been fast asleep at night and all of a sudden you hear a bump somewhere in the house? And you wake up and you look over at your wife and she's fast asleep. So you lean over and say, honey, did you hear that? She's like, what? I heard something in the house. It's a bump in the house. Go see what it is. And then she says, I think that's your job. Oh, yeah. So you reach under your bed, either for the 3-iron or the shotgun, depending on which side of the NRA you stand. Right or the left. You start going through the house. And if you've ever experienced this and you go out and you have been robbed, it's a mortifying experience. It's terrifying. It's an incredible infringement on your rights. And the robber comes not at dinner time when he knows you'll all be sitting around alert. He comes at night. Why? Because he wants to surprise you. He doesn't want you to know when he's coming. What we do know is that Jesus will come like a thief in the night. In other words, when we least expect it. God wants us living our lives as though Jesus might come back at any moment. This is why he doesn't tell us when it's going to happen. This is why it wouldn't surprise me at all if someone actually does figure out the exact date, if God just changes it. Because he doesn't want us to know exactly when, because he wants us to think it might be at any moment, because, my friends, it might be at any moment. While people are saying peace and safety, in other words, while things are going well, Destruction will come on them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not be able to escape. For those who are not in Christ, it will be a horrifying day. But you who are in Christ, brothers and sisters, you're not in darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. We should not be surprised. Why? Because we've listened to this sermon and now we know Jesus can come back at any moment. So we should not be surprised when he arrives. You are all sons of light, daughters of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, here's the application. Let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. And then he goes on to describe what it means to be alert, living as though Jesus could come back at any moment. If I had another 45 minutes, I'd walk you through that text. I don't need to walk you through it. It's really pretty simple. Just read it when you get home and you'll go, oh, this is what it looks like to live as though Jesus might come back at any moment. How do we apply this text that we've looked at today? Well, it depends who you are. When I first started talking about death at the beginning of this sermon, some of you went, oh, is he really going to talk about this for 35 minutes? Because death terrifies you. I mean, terrifies you. And the reason it terrifies you is because you don't know what's going to happen on the other side. Part of the reason you don't know what's going to happen on the other side is because you've never said yes to Jesus. Here's the simple teaching of Scripture, my friends. Simple teaching of Scripture is that Jesus was fully God and fully man. And when he came here to earth, he lived a perfect life. He voluntarily sacrificed himself on the cross, shedding his blood, giving his life for you and for me. He rose again from the dead. Anyone who comes to the cross and says, Jesus, wash me clean, in that moment they are washed. Jesus, make me a new creation. In that moment, we are transformed into a new person. Jesus, come and live within me by your Spirit. In that moment, the resurrected Christ comes to live within them by his Spirit. And everything is changed. You are now, as Scripture says, in Christ, and Christ is in you. And everything that I've just read is true for you. On that day, you will be raised up into the sky, and you will spend forever with God. So my encouragement to you is make today the day. What are you waiting for? We are not promised tomorrow. We're not. I encourage you to say yes to Jesus today. There's another application, obviously, of this text, and it's the main point that I think Paul is making. And that's for some of you who have lost someone that you love, and the pain is still there. You're still feeling it. And the simple teaching of this text is that Jesus is coming back. And we, along with our loved ones in Christ who have died before us, will be with him forever. I was sitting on the back deck of my house a couple Sunday nights ago. All of a sudden, my whole house was empty. None of my family was there. It was dead quiet. It was weird. So I went out there with my book, my G.K. Chesterton book, and a drink. And I'm sitting on the back, and I take a sip of my drink, and all of a sudden, there was something fuzzy in my mouth. Right. And I go like that, and the bee stung me right there on my finger. Which really hurt, but not, I'm guessing, quite as much as if it had stung me in there somewhere. That probably would have really hurt. I had the stinger sticking out of my finger, and it was just pulsating. Poison! Painful poison into my finger. And I pulled it out. And I walked over and I looked at that little beast and I stood there and watched it die a slow and painful death. Took quite a while. While it was dying, I was feeling its pain. I was feeling its sting. It hurt like crazy. Started hurting a little less right after I pulled the stinger out, but it still hurt like crazy. I woke up the next morning, my finger was swollen up. I woke up the next morning, swollen up more. The third morning, my ring was getting very uncomfortably tight as my finger just looked like it had elephantiasis. Took over a week for it to eventually go down. It's finally all better now, except I've got a little hole where that bee sting went in. Right there on my finger. I'm okay with that. Here's the analogy. When the Apostle Paul says, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? He's talking about those of us who are going through death. Those of us who are in Christ, death has no victory over us, and there's no sting. We breathe our last, we're with Jesus. Woo-hoo! This is better. But we leave behind people who deeply love us, and they sting. They sting. It hurts. And Satan, who is dying a slow, miserable death, stings anyone with it that he can. He loves to hurt us. And the first thing we need to do is we need to pull out that stinger. My friends, this passage is designed to help you pull out the stinger. I'm not naive enough to believe that you hear one sermon on this and that all the pain and grief goes away. It doesn't work that way. In the same way that my finger didn't feel instantly better, the pain grew for quite a while, and then it slowly started going away. But you got to get the stinger out. You've got to get the truth in. Here, my friends, is the truth. One day, a trumpet will sound, and the Son of Man will show up, and a voice will get everyone's attention. And those who have gone before us in Christ, and those of us who are still alive in Christ, will be raised up into the sky to meet him. And from that moment on, we will be together forever. My friends, pull the stinger out. Believe that to be true, because it is. And then, as Paul tells us in this text, encourage one another with these words. Please stand. I want to pray for you. And while you're standing, just do this for me. Everyone bow your head and close your eyes. If while I've been preaching, you've been thinking about a specific person that you've lost and that you deeply miss and you're grieved, and even hearing the sermon has made it hurt a little again, and you'd like me just to pray over you, do this. Just raise your hand really high up in the air for me. Yeah. Thank you. Let me pray for you. Lord, you just saw all the hands that went up. You already knew who they were before they raised their hands. But I've just seen how many there are here who are hurting and wounded and grieving and sad and varying degrees of dealing with that grief. And so I want to pray, Lord, that in a supernatural way, you will use this passage of Scripture and the Holy Spirit bringing the truth to light for us to breathe hope and rest into each of their hearts. Supernaturally, you would pull the stinger out. And from this day forth, healing that was before this time not being experienced would be experienced. Lord, that you would start to take the pain away. That we would recognize that not feeling the pain doesn't mean we've forgotten them or we're dishonoring them, but just that we're settling into the healing that you're offering us. So Lord Jesus, please do that. Supernaturally do it. And as a body of believers, enable us by your Spirit to come alongside our friends, our brothers and sisters who are suffering and grieving, and love on them and encourage them with the hope that you've provided in the Word. I thank you for this time together, Lord, and I pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.